Thank you. Well, it's a beautiful night. I think we should be very fired up for prayer. Now, I just want to share a word of exhortation first before we move on. To be united is beautiful. And that was the word Gabriel gave me last Saturday when he came to my house. He gave me a few instructions, but he also gave me this instruction. Say, tell the people to be united. I think the work that we have embarked into, we must stay united. We must stay focused. This is the work of our church. So there must be that unity. Although there is diversity, but we must also come into unity of the Spirit. So let me just share briefly. Let's read from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Tonight, as the Spirit led, we'll pray. And like last week, what we did, continue to prophesy. Get your paper and pen ready, okay? Tonight, we have a few guests. In fact, we have 18 guests. We will tell you who the guests are, okay? So, it's exciting. Things are moving in the spiritual realm. Now, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as He pleased. And if there were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No. Much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on this we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. And if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. And God has appointed this in a church: first, apostles; second, prophets; third, teachers; after that, miracles; then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, varieties of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Do all have gifts of healings? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret, but earnestly desire the best gifts. And yet, I show you a more excellent way. I will elaborate on the more excellent way later, because it's going to be part of our prayer. Do all speak in tongues? Not all. But my wife is beginning to speak in tongues. Praise the Lord. She for many years, she always said, I cannot. But at least today, twice, I pray in tongues with her. Okay? Short, 10 minutes. I don't want to frighten her. But praise the Lord. If the Lord gives, praise the Lord. I think Jonathan make my mentor, Jonathan, he make a point, say, both Pastor Peter and I are different. Very true, he got black hair, I got white hair. He's handsome, I'm more handsome. Very different in many ways. But I think there is one thing that we have common. You know, it is a calling to have a vision of the whole body of Christ. I think it's a privilege. I believe, it's the same for him. I believe when we were first called, already that vision was given in us. I know in my heart that when I went to the mission school, I was already talking about the whole body of Christ. I was never satisfied with just one church, the work of one church. And I always had that sense of detachment, that when the Lord moves me on, I'll go on. And I believe that is the calling to have that vision. I believe Pastor Peter has that. And this is why the Lord has raised us to our office of a prophet and an apostle. And this is my prayer tonight, that every one of us, we see big. I think it was yesterday, I went out lunch with Jonathan and Amy, and then we passed by one big church, beautiful church. But in my heart, I said, that was their only vision. They had only vision of one church. Their vision was only limited to that one church. Outside, make it so nice, everything, but it was just one church. Now, I don't, like I say, it is a calling to have that vision. But having said that, all of us must not be limited by our own self, limited view. We must set our eyes on the kingdom of God. I believe all of us here, we each have been given a ministry in the local church. By all means, pursue it, do your best, but always give time, always set aside time for the bigger picture. Stay united. That is the message Gabriel told me, and he reminded me, remember the highway. And he made me to recall the vision again. And he said, see, observe again. And sometime, a bit barren, we can see one time, but we don't see all. So he said, see again, what did the Lord tell you? Observe and record. And I saw the vision again. I saw the highway again. And again, wow, now I really see people. At first, I was saying, I see many people working. But now I saw there are people working in different sections. They each have their ministry. Each local church have their own work. But there is that sense of joy, because it is working on the main project, and that's the highway. And the marker, I mentioned about markers along the way. This is the last part of the highway. I saw many markers. Some markers are of shorter interval, some are of longer interval. And I saw Every one of us are working towards that marker. There is no rush to work beyond that marker before others have reached. That is the sense of unity that the Lord is talking about, the oneness in spirit. Therefore, continue in your own ministry that the Lord has called you. Some of you may have some ministry outside the church. Continue, but join us together in the spirit, the church, in seeing the big picture. I've come to understand the Lord has mobilized many other forces all over the world. Even at this present moment, there are people going prayer walk, there are people going to places, establishing the kingdom of God. And we are part of it. And this is the vision that we need. And, you know, here we have diversity, although as each member, but there is one spirit. What impressed me most is the verse here. Some of the members may seem to be weaker, you know. In my the last 13 years as a missionary, myself and my disciples, we have planted more than 2,000 churches. I tell you, this is very evident. No church are perfect with every member, all very committed, you know, all very right in your mind. In every church, there are always a few not so there. You cannot select, you know. In my Cambodian church, the Lord has blessed us tremendously because we look after the weaker part. We gave honor to the widows, the orphans, to the older people, to the children. And the Lord blessed us. And this is the principle for our churches. That there are some who seem to be weaker. Let's not discredit them. Let's give our love and patience to them. It's not easy, okay? Now, I stand here, I talk. It's not easy, you know. It's easier said than done, okay? Because sometimes some of these weaker people give you a lot of headache. Delay you, you know, you got something to do. Hey, pastor, you know. But, you know, we have to do it as unto the Lord. Now, there are also, I've seen my disciples, especially in Thailand. I had 5 disciples. And, you know, after training them, I sent them out. They started planting churches. But I saw that they also quarrel among themselves. It is human. They want to get more favor from me, or they want to show a little bit more to me, prove to me more. You know, that kind of thing. And it grieves me, you know, to see them like that. But it takes a lot of patience with them. I have to tell them, hey, we are working towards one church. Not your church, not my church, but one church. So I believe this is the message from the Lord through Gabriel. Last week we started well. I think last week I think all of us felt energized, you know, focused. But that was just the beginning. Okay. Just now James was asking me, Pastor, you haven't shared about Israel. I say, no yet lah. We have still a few more things to go. But it will pick up. The momentum will pick up. But we need, You see, we need to build that up. And building up is not just momentum, you know, our spirit, we need to gel. We need to come in with oneness of spirit. You know, in verse 25, it says here, there should be no division in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. I would like to change the word a bit here. There should be no division in each of our ministry or calling. But in fact, we should have the same care for another person's ministry. And of course, the main ministry is the Lord's kingdom. As pastors of this church, we are going to lead you into the kingdom, I mean into this revival movement. Every ministry that you are involved in contributes to it. But every ministry that we are talking about, every vision we are talking about, also contributes to your ministry. So there must be that synergy together so that we can really press forward. And Paul say, and yet I show you a more excellent way. Now let's turn to Revelation. I want to start with the church of Ephesus. But first, let me drink water. It really, the idea of the pouch, water pouch, is good idea. Because I mean now, disrupt, that's our difference. He doesn't drink a drop. I drink two tumbler there. Never mind, it's okay. In all the churches, in the seven churches, at the end of each church, you will read, like for example, chapter 2, verse 7, it says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The work that is completed in the seven churches, my prayer walk, the anointing that is received, it is not just for our church. It is to the churches in the world. And that is how big, how ultimate this vision is. Our work, our prayer is going to impact. As I share gradually, I think both of us, we hope to be able to transmit that vision to you. But already I have my travel plan for this year and the next year, the countries that I have to go. And this is not sightseeing, you know. Got to walk, you know. Now I'm buying extra, I'm going to bring extra pair of socks. Already my route in Russia, I think I'm going to walk at least 400 kilometers. I think this trip, Sharma said, okay, I think that distance good enough. So, and it's going to be, I'm going to bring back that knowledge, that vision, and I'm going to share here each time I come back from the place, and then we're going to pray, and we're going to release, and the angels are going to come and collect all those prayer and then go back. It is, it's already resonating to the angels here. On Monday, we went to pray in Singapore, prayer walk. And that's why I say there are 18 visitors. There were 18 angels from 18 churches in Singapore that came to our prayer walk. And they are here tonight. Pastor Peter will share more on that. Now, let's turn to chapter 2, verse 2. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered and have patience and have labor for my name's sake and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. It is a very shaking revelation, you know. You can do so much. And here, verse 2 also mentioned about patience. Verse 3 also mentioned about patience. I think this church, they are very enduring people, very patient. Yet all this, without love, is nothing. You can bear evil, but without love, is nothing. You can labor for the lost name's sake and not become weary, but yet if you have no love, it is nothing. This is why in verse 5 it says, remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works. Or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. The first works talks about the works of love. Every act we do, from now, I'm going to pray that we are convinced, let's do it with love. Within our community here, love for our brothers and sisters out there. It has to be with love. We must break this for the first church. Tonight, when we pray, let's think about this. We were saying, hey, there are more than 400 churches in Singapore. No? But only 18 angels came. Wow, that is how many percent? 2, 3, 4, 5. 4 to 5%. Let's pray for the rest. There are many other, the rest of the 6 churches have characteristics, but I want to just share on this first. Then after that, as we go into prayer, as the Lord did, I will share some more. So, let's get our works right. Let there be no ego or self-centeredness. Let's do all this with love for the Lord. For the Lord, the name of our Lord's sake. And you know, this is the only thing, this is the gel, this is the glue, the cement that will, you know, when we put a cobblestone of prayer, that will be the cement that was strengthened the highway. And I feel that I hope that in the Lord's grace, one day, you know, or even tonight, the glory of the Lord will come and for us to see His glory, and that will give us that extra, you know, to do this work. I will share later more. Now I pass it to Pastor Peter.
Praise God. Some of you are wondering, after we have received the anointing, when Pastor David came back on a Saturday, you were anointed and you received the anointing of triumph. And then following that was the Friday, which was last Friday, and you received an anointing for prophecy. And you prophesy as the Lord led you, and you place some of your prophecies that God has given into the golden box where we continue to pray. And there was also a question that came in an email that asked me, where in the Bible is the spirit of triumph? Because we brought the triumph back from the church in Pergamos. And the anointing was the anointing of triumph. And in all the 7 churches, the message was, to him who overcomes. And apparently there's some things that have been overcome in the spirit. So when the Bible is the spirit of triumph. And there are several places, but I like to point to the one in the book of Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. Abraham was tested. There is always a price that is paid before every triumph. Because particularly here in Abraham's life, he was tested. And in this test, it was a test of his love for God. How much does he love God? And does he love God enough to give to God everything that God has blessed him thus far, which is his son? And Abraham was very rich because the Lord blessed him. But I believe it is harder to give up his son than to give up everything else that he has. And moreover, he has his relationship with the son, and his son is a living being. And it's much harder to give up a living being and his only son than to give up all the silver and gold and the treasures that he has. And yet, Abraham yielded to the Lord, took his son up to the place that God appointed, and obediently was willing to sacrifice his son, knowing that if at all that he died in the sacrifice, God would have raised him up. We all know from many teachings how he always say to them that we were returned. So there was some faith that he showed. He says in verse 5, we will come back. Not I will come back. We will come back. So he had confidence that even if he gave to God his son, God would give it back, give him back to him. And that faith was there. And throughout the whole process, when he's completed the right up to the last second. Say, how close was he to actually sacrificing his son? You can see that in verse 10, Abraham, he has to take time. He in verse 9, he took time to build an altar. Now that might take some time because the altar has to be big enough to put his son on. And that might be half an hour, or maybe an hour if the stones are big. And place the wood in order. So then he has to go and find wood. And in a forest, you might have to go, you know, several places to get the type of wood you want in order to start a fire. And if anyone has ever started a wood fire before, you must have the big sticks and then you must have the smaller ones. And all those things are put in order. Plus, you got to have the dried stuff like moss to catch the first wave of fire and slowly light it. And how do you know? Well, because when we moved to Canberra first time, we were excited to have what I call a wood fire heater. And the first house, one of the houses that we stayed had a wood fire heater. So it was very nice because then we always think, you know, of the ambient atmosphere where you can toast your marshmallows. And so with that, and the first time I tried to start that wood fire, it was not easy. And I tried everything and then I realized, because I put a big lump of wood, boom, inside, that it was not easy. And I realized that to start the wood fire, you can put the wood there, but you have to put smaller, and then bigger, and bigger pieces. The fire has to actually slowly grow. And so you got to actually start with the small little pieces. And then as the small little pieces grow, and then you reach a certain intensity, then you put bigger and bigger pieces. You put a big fat one in, choom, the whole fire goes off. And it's just not enough heat to catch fire. So you got to actually, it's skill there. So you can imagine, he has to lay all kinds of wood already to start a fire. I mean, he didn't bring all these things that we have in a modern invention, you know, fire starters and all those. He just had to do it from scratch. And so it took some time to get all the wood. And I mean, the angel was watching. And Isaac, by that time, You know, he was a willing sacrifice too. He's not like after he had done everything, Isaac ran away. Then next year he could look for Isaac. Where are you? Ran away. And then part of the scene, if you're a movie, you'll be chasing through the jungle, all over the place, swinging all over. Finally he captured Isaac, and then he knocked him unconscious, dragged him to the sacrifice. Halfway Isaac woke up and said, "Oh, please dad, please don't kill me, don't kill me." You know. And then after that they go wrestle. By that time Isaac could have been a strong person too. And they fight and fight, and then Abraham knocked him unconscious again. Whatever. Such things never occur. Only in your imagination. But Isaac was a willing sacrifice. And I believe he just lay himself down. And then Abraham actually bound him to the thing. It was as if he really willing to go through the whole process. And finally, and the angel was watching all the time. God was watching all the time. And up to the point where he actually took the knife. And he was about to plunge it into Isaac. You talk about the last minute God. This is the last second. He could have, after seeing him put Isaac there, bound him, he could say, "That's enough." Why must he wait until he take up the knife? And right to the last second, how many seconds does it take to move the knife that 2-3 feet? That's just a few seconds. That's it. And the angel had to wait until he got, and he really was going to do, because after all God told him, this is special, don't anyone try this at home. And so in just a few seconds, and he was not like slow motion, and then hey, I'm ready. No, he was literally going to. And the angel says, "Stop!" He was really going to do it. And so you think about it, the angel waited until the last second. And then said, "That's enough!" Right up to the point to see all his willingness and his heart of love. That was painful for Isaac to give himself, painful for Abraham to give himself, but it was all out of the love for God. And then the angel provided the ram, sacrificed the ram, but here comes the blessing. Abraham was already blessed. Blessings were pronounced over his life in Genesis chapter 12, and then repeated again in Genesis 15. And always, you know, you are blessed, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you, all the families of the earth will be blessed through you. And in Romans 4, he was called that through the process he inherit the earth. Now, if God gave a promise that all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you, it's obvious that he was the channel now. The only channel. And we know that that channel became Christ. Because in Galatians chapter 3 verse 13 and 14, it says that the blessings of Abraham has now come to the Gentiles, to Christ, by the Holy Spirit. And so that blessing has continued to come. And that's why Romans 4 says, Abraham inherited the whole earth. He was given the title deed to the whole earth. So when you hold the title deed to the earth, which is now in Christ's hand, because Abraham was a forerunner of a type of Christ, in a sense, type of Father God, and Isaac was like the son, and pointing to Christ, that Christ now holds the title deed. But it's wonderful to think that he inherited the earth. Now think about it this way. If you hold the title deed to your house, I cannot come and say, "That piece of furniture is mine, that table is mine, the fridge is mine." I can't, right? The whole house is yours. And everything that is inside, you have it, you could have bought it, but the whole house, you hold the title deed of the house and everything inside your house. I cannot come and say, "This is mine, that is mine." Think about it. This whole planet, all the silver and gold, all the riches, all the finances, all the trillions of dollars that are being exchanged in all the stock market, all the business transactions that are going on, trillions upon trillions of dollars, all this wealth. If the title deed was with Abraham, and the title deed is now in Christ, who do you think it belongs to?
Abraham and the seed of Abraham to Christ, which means that it should now flow to the seed of Abraham. And the angels are looking to that to make sure it flows to the seed of Abraham. But how will it flow to the seed of Abraham? Will we have to fight for it? What will we have to do? The Bible tells us that of all the blessings that was pronounced on Abraham, there was one tiny bit different in Genesis 22. Different from Genesis 12, different from Genesis 15. Just one added phrase that was never before. Never mentioned in Genesis 12 to Abraham. Never mentioned in Genesis chapter 15 to Abraham. Never mentioned in Genesis 17 to Abraham when he was 99 years old. But only now. After he went to the last second to be willing to give up all. This was what the Lord through the angel said. Verse 17, blessing, I will bless you. Multiplying, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. Your descendants shall possess the gates of their enemies. That is the new part. So what God was saying to Abraham is, all these things that you do is to receive the spirit of triumph. To possess the gates of your enemies means you conquer your enemies. So he has received the spirit of conquest, the spirit of victory, the spirit of triumph, or rather, the blessing of triumph, the blessing of victory, the blessing of conquest, not for himself, because he has conquered. Whatever he did was for his descendants, which includes you and I in Christ. Whatever he did was passed on down the line to us. And there is a difference between having to work and receiving the results of the work. There is a difference between having to conquer and being more than a conqueror. The Bible tells us that in Christ, in Romans 8, you all know the words, we are more than conquerors. So how can, after a conqueror, more than conquerors, what is more than conqueror? When you don't have to conquer, someone conquer for you. And after they conquer, you say, welcome, enjoy the conquest. We enjoy the spoils which Abraham had received the spirit of triumph in order that Christ has done the work for us. That is why it is not so much us trying to work. Although we are outwardly doing, it's not really us trying to do it. It is actually us walking in the works. When we receive the spoils of somebody else's conquest, you enjoy the conquest of someone else. For example, if you're a good father and mother and you're a good provider, your children are blessed because of what you accumulate and could bless their lives. So your children are blessed because of the hard work you do. And many parents work hard in order that the children would have education, the children will be provided for, that the children will have the opportunities that the parents might not have. And they had all those things that they pushed forward. Their children inherit. Did the children have to, of course, sadly, some children have to fight for themselves from young and some to earn at the same time trying to do it themselves. But when it's all provided for you, you still got to do it. You have the opportunity given unto you. So when you bring forward into Christ in the New Testament, you have in the book of Ephesians chapter 2. And the reason why we touch on these things is We need to know what we have received. You need to know what you receive when you were anointed with the spirit of triumph. Because if you don't know what you have received when you receive the spirit of triumph, you will be like someone who bought a ticket to go on a cruise. And throughout the cruise, you don't have to go to the dining table. You just stay in your room all the time. And you don't dare to go to all their amusements and all the things that are inside the ship because you didn't have money. So you tap out your own food. The cruise lasted 10 days. 10 days you ate packed food. On your last day, rice with soya sauce. Whatever. At the end of the cruise, you realize your food was included. Well, everybody was feasting away. You didn't know that all those was yours. So you never took advantage of that. Because you thought you still got to earn your food. You thought you had to use money to get the food. Or if you don't have money, you got to do some work to earn that food. And that's what sometimes Christians are doing. When the spirit of triumph is received, is telling you it is finished. It's finished in some manner. Now, it is not that Pastor David pay all the price and finish it. No. He was the tail end to many people who over 3,000 years has paid with their lives. Some of them martyred, paid the price of blood, and many intercessors. By the time Pastor David went there, the Lord has shown him through Gabriel that he is one of many who will build a highway under the sixth marker. He's not the only one. But it's always when the finale, you know, God does choose the last person to do the finale too. And it's just like if you have a hard object, let's say, and everyone come and try to bang on the box. Well, the box solid, didn't crack. Then, who knows, by the 670th punch, boom, the box burst. The 670th person says, see how strong I am. If he had started with number one, it might not have happened. He happened to be number 670. Because it took 670 punches to make it a crack in it. And so in that way, the highway was shown to Pastor David to let him know that he, by the grace of God, as one of those builders of the cobblestones, uniquely chosen by a lightning strike and sent to walk and uniquely sent off from our little group here, prayed and sent up with all our prayers going along with him from this place. That's why we were the first also to receive the anointing when he came back and released to go out and capture something that the angels had been waiting for 3,000 years. You say, hey, but church is only 2,000 years. Because that place was in darkness. And 1,000 years before, already God planned the idolatry that was all those things. And they were going forth, praying that they would have what you call a beachhead on the planet Earth. If you know what I mean. Maybe, they did say 3,000 years, right? That place. They used 3,000 years. And you think 3,000 years, that's 1,000 years before Christ. So, the enemy had encamped themselves. And that place was unique because it was the Acropolis. It was a symbol of Greece. And you know how powerful Greece influence was. It went into the Romans. And then it became the Roman Empire with the Greek influence still there. Although the Romans are Italian, from Italy, province of Italy. The Greek, it was the Greek Empire was the first empire of Daniel. That is significant. That laid the groundwork for the Antichrist. Although you have the Egyptian Empire, and then you have the Babylonian Empire, and the Middle Persian Empire, but the Greek Empire was specially mentioned in that at that time when it rose, there was a spirit of the... Of course, spirit Antichrist Babylon is always there. But something happened about 1,000 years before Christ. They sort of set a seal that the angels were trying to undo. And 1,000 years BC, what was going on? Well, at that time, Israel was still was receiving the covenant of God and doing the things of God. But God only worked in one nation. God is interested in the world. And then finally, now the angels, after 3,000 years, on February the 9th, has a beachhead. We all know what a beachhead was. In the Second World War, Germany conquered the countries by the Blitzkrieg method. They just roll in, vroom, and very fast they conquer one country after the other fell. Until in Europe, the only country left standing was the island of Great Britain. And of course, Russia was on the other extreme. All the countries are boom in a blitzkrieg. And it looked like Germany has won. It took some time. And you know, if the Americans did not help, and if Americans didn't enter the war, it might be too late. By the time England got enough strength to conquer back, everybody in the first generation, second generation might have be speaking Germany by that time. German. But when America entered the war, that was a turning point. But even when they entered the war, fresh into the war, at first they were neutral. When they entered the war, there was a strategy how to fight. How to conquer back Europe. Not easy. And there was a big plan that was done. See, at which point did the Germans started losing? When they landed as a beachhead. Forgot what they played, Dunkirk or whatever. Normandy, yes. And you all read the story. How they invaded back. And how they had to plan a deception too. To deceive the Germans that they thought it was coming from somewhere else. And then it came from this place. It was the many men lost their life as they went in under German gunfire. But the moment they get in, is they got a beachhead. They have gone in. They succeeded. They are now on the mainland. It's hard to fight a war from the island. You got to go to the mainland, then you can at least bring your tanks in. And so finally they got a beachhead. From that time on, Germany started to lose. It took them a couple more, a bit more time before they totally lost. By that time, Russia was also fighting back. But the tide had turned. Hey, the Germans are still in Paris. The Germans are still in Amsterdam. The Germans are still in all these other places. But that was the turning point. So what happened at Pergamos? What has been brought to us? The angels that have been waiting to conquer back the earth, to cause all the natural forces to be there. See, didn't Jesus did that on the cross? Jesus paid the price for it, and the church launched forth. The church did. But as the church launched forth, the church did many things. Planted churches, Paul went all over the place. But the darkness, the church might even have surrounded that that place. But the church never did conquer that beachhead. 3,000 years, they said. They give 3,000 years. And of course, they were waiting a few centuries for someone like you. Tune the lightning correctly as we joke. And 3,000 years. You say, how is that possible? All right. Israel had no Jerusalem during the time of the judges. That was about 300 years. So where was the ark? In Shiloh. Shiloh, by the way, it was another word for the Messiah. It said, Judah shall, the scepter shall not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes. From Genesis 49. We'll look at that on Thursday Bible study. Shiloh for 300 years. Then 7 months it was taken by the Philistines. Then it went for 20 years in Gerja Jairim. It was waiting for one man. The man's name, David. This man's name, what do you say his name was? Tengnang. This man's name was David. Can you see there's no coincidence even in his name? And by the way, why do you choose the name David?
My sister gave me the name.
There you go. No coincidence. Do you know that when the Bible prophesied that when Israel come together, that it will fulfill the prophecy of David, the tabernacle of David will be restored? Who was the first prime minister of Israel? David. Do you think his name is coincidental? Why wouldn't his name be Methuselah or Melchizedek? Because I want you to know this. When angels work, they work with the precision of thousands of scientists putting together a rocket ship. If you ever work with angels, work with spirit beings and work with God and the Holy Spirit, the precision, you know, to send someone to space, to the moon, although the people who went to the moon take all the glory, and no, few of them, a handful, there are at least 3,000 to 5,000 scientists working very hard to put them there, to keep them alive and to bring them back. And precision is very important. There are thousands of mathematical calculations, thousands of engineers, thousands of inventors, because literally everything has to be invented to make that process possible. And it's with such precision that when the angels organize a fulfillment of prophecy, they ensure that the clay vessel chosen to do the finale part when Easter came together must be named David. And when the church has that breakthrough, also is named David. And when Israel for the first time managed to enter into the place that God had prophesied all this time, I don't know, if you ask me in the natural, why God choose that place to be our beachhead? Why not choose Singapore? Or in Taiwan, there's a group of Christians who think that there's one place called Zion. Every country wants their holy place and their mount of holiness to build it, put the ark there. And but God knows how the earth was created. God knows all the points where the energy points are. And God knows where he must get a beachhead. Which means that Israel, 300 years after they got the promised land. Now 300 years, many people live and die. Joshua lived and died. They never got a place. The Bible even told them, there will be one day a place that I choose. And only when I choose that place, and you put my ark there, you build my tabernacle there, everything will come together. Hallelujah. Everything will come together. Because they struggle to be great. They struggle to be a theocratic nation. They didn't survive well. They needed to find that place, to put the ark in the right place. 300 years, not really there yet. 6-7 months taken by the Philistines. 20 years in Kirjath Jearim. And the one day, David, the eighth son of Jesse, was used by God to take it in. But it took some time for David too. It took some time. But the moment David became king over all Israel, his first thing that he did, he conquered and made Jerusalem the capital. Finally, they got the place that God wanted. Kirjath Jearim was very near, but not yet. You know why near but not yet? Why 20 years? Because God was waiting for a man named David. And he did it. He was the first to go in. So I could imagine that even though Israel had really, literally, in a sense, conquered the whole land, under Joshua it was conquered, in the major places were conquered. 300 years in the judges, up and down, up and down, up and down. And then under Samuel, and for 20 odd years, and part of it under Saul. So we realized that they were waiting near the edge of Jerusalem. Kirjath Jearim was about 15 miles from Jerusalem, waiting to go in. And the moment they conquered Jerusalem, it was so important a battle that David said. And Jerusalem is so strong. So strong that they even dare to say, no one can do this. You read the story in the book of 2 Samuel. And David says, whoever conquers will be my commander-in-chief. That was a reward for conquering that. Joab did it. He led an army right through. He found a way through the water channel. He conquered. Because it was impossible in other ways. And that was the beachhead. That was the turning point. When Israel finally is settled. And then the greatness. At which point did Israel started becoming great? Right? After Joshua, boom! Then Joshua died, they went that way. Judges came, they came back. Judges died, they went back. Another judge came, they came back. Another judge came, they went back. Another judge came, they go. Another judge died, they went back. Another judge came, they go. Another judge, some long, some short. They were doing the waltz all the time. And finally, Samuel came. Whoa. But when Samuel came, the word was rare in those days. So we're just coming back out from backsliding. And then Saul arose. Everybody say, Then Saul backslide. And David came. Finally, no more swinging, swinging, toing and froing. It is only when David rose and ruled that the turning point came. It was that turning point that Israel came, became greater and greater and greater and greater and greater and greater, and it reached its height spiritually under David, and then it reached its height in the natural under Solomon. So what the angels have done and what David has done in that trip and got the spirit of triumph was that the angels symbolically in that place have now got a beachhead on the earth. That is why this revival that is coming forth is different from any other revival. All other revivals are like the revivals in the book of Judges. Right, if the angel says, 3,000 years, they never got that. And when it was done, all the angels from all the whole planet Earth and all the men of God from up there came down. 3,000 years. Which means the whole of the church age, every revival that's taken place, even the one in Acts, even the Wales revival, even the first great awakening, even the second great awakening, and even all the revivals in Indonesia like a mighty wind, and all the revivals that we've seen here and there, could not bring the beachhead down. But now that beachhead has come down, this revival is more powerful than we realize. We have a responsibility to pray. Now, not every all night is going to be like that, because David is going to go on his trip. But what we have done in all the other all nights have been the correct formula. Which means that once we finish this phase, and then you do your travels, we will go back, dimming the lights again, and let you pray for 4 or 5 hours in the spirit. But understand this, you will now have been anointed with a special spirit to pray through. Which is why, if you begin to fast, we're going to get a fast on the 15th of April to the 22nd of April. Then another, that's 7-day fast. 22nd you can break your fast. And then another fast from May the 1st to May the 21st. And like Angel, she just fasted this week, wasn't it? Yeah. And she must have you must have fasted before many times. But this fast was different. Because this fast you did after you were anointed. And remember one of the principles of the anointing. When you fast, the full anointing that you receive come forth. And when God anointed Kenneth Hagin on his hands, on his palm, Jesus appeared to him and said, "This anointing I give to you." And he says, when the anointing wax and wane, fast and pray. Because now when you fast and pray these 7 days, and these 21 days, it is different. You have received the spirit of triumph. It is already in your spirit. The impact is different and greater. And that which comes forth will be more powerful than you realize. Which is why the Lord led us to call for fast and pray. Every revival for all of every church has to begin somewhere. Nobody owns the revival. The revival owns us. Nobody owns the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit owns us. Nobody owns the angel. The angels are owned by God, and we are their charges. They have charge over us. God owns the revival. But we need to understand that in the spirit world, a beachhead has come forth. And in this revival that God is bringing forth, the way and the manner in which it comes has been different. The preparation, exquisite, precise, disciplined, and require this kind of prayer. Because in this revival, this is the first phase of this revival. The prophetic phase, where the pillars are being laid. This is like they just conquered and they enter Normandy. And now they got to plan strategic conquest. The planes will do their part to bomb the strongholds. The soldiers still got to march in. Conquest is not finished until you march in. The day will come when marching comes in. And all over in the Second World War, even in Northern Africa, the tide was turning. And the tide is turning. And in this great revival, That's the first phase. In the second phase will be a gathering of people more and more until it reaches critical mass. And after it reaches critical mass, there will be a third phase. And in the third phase, there will be some manifestations of the presence of God. And as the third phase increases, and even more gather, people will take bits and parts of the fire and go take it from all over the world. Just like Azusa Street. And then by that time, there will be a time at God appoint where miracles start flowing. Signs and wonders. Healing miracles. Like of old, but with new ones. And then, it will be a curve that goes exponentially. Shoom. It will touch a place where creative miracles will take place. People's whose heart has been replaced by machines suddenly get a new heart. Don't know what will happen to the machine. Catherine Kuhlman's time, a few miracles like that, the machine just disappeared. Some people say the machine dropped out. Where? From where? And people whose one kidney taken, live on one kidney, boom, the other kidney came back. People's hand chopped off or lost to accidents or factories, as they worship God, shoom, the hand comes out. People who lost an eye, suddenly the eyes came back. It will be like never before. And by that time, the presence of God will be so thick that there's an awesomeness greater than like Moses couldn't enter the tabernacle. Like Acts 5 where there's so much love but so much fear too of the Lord. And that will be where God is leading us. But let's understand that we are right there and spiritual Normandy has taken place. There's still a lot of work to do. There's still some work to be done. And we need to strengthen what has been done. And that is why in Ephesians chapter 2, it says we are not saved by our own works, but we are saved and predestined. In chapter 2, verse 7. In the ages to come, that is our age especially, He might show the exceeding riches of His grace in His kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. He said, it's not the first type of works, which is a works in order to conquer, works in order to have victory, works in order to triumph. The triumph has already been given to you in the Spirit. And all you have to do is release the anointing in your life through spending time with God, through consecration of your life, through fasting and prayer. And it says, this is a gift of God, not a work, lest anyone should boast. Verse 10, we are His workmanship, created in Jesus for good works. But it never say that we do them. It just say, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Because the victory is yours. And you just walk in them. You just walk into the spoils. Walk into the blessings that God has for you. And so what should we do from the victory anointing that is received, the spirit of triumph? One of those things was prophecy, to speak them forth. The other is to fast and pray. The other is to meditate on God's word. And most of all, to believe what you have received. And most of all, the pillars that make up the cobblestone, the pillars that make up the foundation, the cobblestones that build the highway, were made from prayer. We need to pray. But this time the prayer is different. There is a difference. And as you pray, it is like, instead of being in London waiting for the V2 rockets to hit you, the battle is now that you conquer Normandy and you're looking, okay, which city should I conquer first? So say, what should we do? When you pray, you're releasing things to the north, to the south, to the east, to the west. And that's what has been done in this nation, where all the angels have asked. In fact, the captain of the angels over Singapore went specially asked for, hey, bring the anointing to us too. And we have done that on Monday. And when we went all over the place, and now we can put the chart up and show the chart of the prayer drive that was on Monday. And we divided Singapore into four quadrants. North, south, east, west. And so we took note that, now these are all the little diagrams that I put. And then in our first prayer walk, which we did together, and then Jonathan, you were with us too, and Sister Gunn here took us around. There was only 1, 2, 3 of us, right? Yeah, three of us. Sister Gunn here was a driver. Let me stand on that side so I don't block anybody. And so we went around, and we noticed that there was one angel here. And this angel was above an area at Mount Faber. He was standing over a very tall tree and looking down towards the main city suburbs of Singapore. And you realize that more or less your main economic activity happens in here between Orchard Road and the Marina Bay and all these things. Is like your the central point of your heart, your economy, if you're gonna put if you're an international company, you want to put a headquarters here, you want to put your headquarters somewhere in Tuas, right? You might have your factory there or something, but you have your main thing somewhere where you know everybody is gathered there. So that's where also this angel was looking out. And then over on the east side, there were two angels, one with a sword pointing inwards, not outwards, surprisingly. And then there's the other angel too, and they were at a river that was why is this one so big, this river? There's no such thing so big. Oh yeah, okay, this is Pulau Ubin, sorry. Okay, my map of Singapore. Okay, somewhere here, I think somewhere going in here, okay. And going in here, and the first trip, I didn't pay too much attention to, you know, why the angel had a sword and all those things. But subsequently, by that time, by the second trip, I knew where his sword was pointing at. It was pointing towards your airport. Your airport has the most coming and going. I think millions every year. And as much as your population, I think now they're thinking of build a bigger airport, maybe 10 million come through or whatever, to prevent 30 million. 13, you see, more than your population. And so that I think the angels are pointing the sword there so that anybody with demons and all that, they park the demons outside in the air, and they come, you can enjoy your country. Then and they go out, and they, as they go on the plane, then the demons say, okay, join them again, and then you know, go back wherever they came from, whatever. This is just something happened in the spiritual. Just like when demons accompany people to church, you know, demons don't go in and sing Hallelujah or Amazing Grace with them. Demons park themselves outside the church and wait till whoever they're following finish. When they come out of church, they jump back on there and go home, right? Like they're pets or something like that. And so anyway, there's this angel watching over an important point in the spiritual realm. Then there is this angel in the north, is moving to and fro all the time. This angel, by the way, each angel got different character. This angel are very much like Pastor David, know, very excited. Right? And when you pray, he goes, okay. And then this angel was there over in the west. And so that was our first trip. Now, during this trip last Monday, when we went, before Pastor David went, Shama has already mentioned that the angels of the churches there. In Singapore, there are 400 odd churches, and that some of the churches and the angels will also be joining it and be part of it. And because, as you know, revival is not just for our church, and neither are we planting the church here just for here. We pray they be influenced to the rest of the body of Christ. We pray that we'll be unifying force. And of course, with everything, you've got to start somewhere. And I believe we will. I'm sure other people are also praying in Singapore, praying all over the world and all that. But here is one of the most consistent all-night prayers. Every Friday, until Eddie says they pray more than some pastors. And we will keep praying that. And that's happening. Which is there. And so some of the angels will bring whatever prayer, spirit, or whatever things to encourage their local pastors that they are in charge over, to tell them, you know, pray more, you know, follow God more, so that then when God begins to pour His Spirit, they will also be blessed. So over in, when we went to this part here, now this person here, that's Shama. Okay, I gave him the authority looking thing that he was. And so when we went to the south, there were five angels. I let Pastor David share some details afterward what one of the angels spoke to him. But there were five there that joined us. And then when we went to the east, there were three that joined us. And then when we were there, Michael the archangel showed up. That's him over there, just in picture form. And so this whole group was there, and the original two angels are still there. When we went to the north, seven angels from this section in the north joined us there. And then when we went to the west, three angels over there, and a prayer was made that was there. And this is Singapore, and we are praying because God has chosen your nation. God has chosen this place to pour out His Spirit. And of course, right now on the internet, some other nations say, me, 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 right? Of course, you know, the revival will be for everyone. And just like right now, you know, while we are here, somewhere in Beach Road, somewhere here probably, and we are praying here, and so the angels in the other churches, you know, will be wanting their pastors, and the pastors there will be saying, me, 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 yes lah, it's for everybody. But it must start somewhere. It must always start somewhere. And when God wanted to save the entire planet, He has to first take one race of people, and then work through them, and when able to work finish through them, then it spread out through all the world. The same way, God has to start somewhere. And that is our responsibility, to make sure that this tidal wave and outpouring that has begun in the Spirit is allowed to increase, is allowed to flow, is allowed to build until it becomes stronger and stronger, and it just floods this place with the presence of God and overflow through us. And those who are supposed to hear will be here. And what's our destiny? One of the visions when you receive him, here's a Pergamos, right? We got a 600, we saw our church in Dublin, 600 people. Okay, it has to do with our critical mass. And 600 people belong to this church for the critical mass. They are not here yet. It is your job to pray them in. So what? Yes, because until we reach that stage, our impact on the other churches is still building. So they are not here yet means either some of them not born again yet, haven't joined us, or some of them could still be in sin and they're too far away to come back, or some of them are not hearing the Spirit and they're not here yet. And by the way, in that region, we are not in this place. This place cannot contain 600. Which means God will also lead us from this place to another place. Most likely, we begin to start filling up slowly. And somewhere along the way, God is going to provide a place for us. And as we move into that place, and then you will know. You know, everyone talk about revival and everyone you receive some anointing. You say, hey, go back. You say, hey, boleh, sama-sama. Right? Because it's still the prophetic phase. But as we begin to move and begin to go to the other place, which God already has begun to show me some things. See, this prophetic is supposed to go run all over the place. Apostolic is supposed to build foundation, let him go. So God is already showing where the place is, where the leadings of the places are, and all those things. And because that's my job, that's my responsibility to lead, to build until the critical mass. By the time we reach a critical mass, as the 600 people who haven't come in yet, so your job, pray until the 600 are full. Now, in the meantime, while God bringing the 600 here, He will also touch the 18 churches that are there and continue to turn them towards more and more revival. And some of them could be churches bigger than us, but not yet touched into the place of the Spirit. I always believe this thing, that if you build in the Spirit, the natural will follow. So if you build yourself the most strongest church spiritually, in the natural you will be the number one church. Because natural follow the spiritual. It's just a matter of time. And that's why building the Spirit is most important. And the thing about it is, though we are small, Deuteronomy applies to us. When Jesus said, Jesus, I love you, Jesus, always have your name on my lips. When Moses said to the Israelites before they cross over, his last delivery called Deuteronomy, the second giving of the law, or actually Deuteronomy is three giant sermons that he gave, lasting 34 chapters long. And when he spoke among them, he says, you were not the most powerful nation. You're not the most powerful people. But because I love you, I have sent you forth. And he even told them in Deuteronomy, that applies to us right now, you're the smallest. You're the tiniest. You're nobody, uncultured, just came from Egypt. Not even having a proper civilization. Not even having a proper government. Not even having proper training in all the things that make a great nation. But I have chosen you. COG has been chosen. We are not the biggest in this land yet. We are not the most well-known yet. But we have a job to do. We have to wage in prayer warfare what Joshua waged in natural warfare. But warfare in the spirit is not so much struggling. We wage it like the angels, thanking God for what He has given. And thanking God for all the new place, for all the 600 souls that He has given. Of course, you all know already that from 1979, I have already been praying for 1 billion souls. Say, will I receive it? Yes. You know why? Because in 1979, I had a list of 10 things. Over time, I expanded it to 14. Number 7 was that I want to visit heaven. That was answered in 2006. and number two was 1 billion souls. And planting churches in all the five continents, some churches as big as 10,000, some 100,000, some a million, but 1 billion souls. So God answered my number six. And he's in the process of answering some of the numbers there. And this is not shortcut. Started in 1979. I gave David a glimpse. I cover. I said, hey, look, this part is that number. And only David know that number that I showed you that day. The things that we discussed, we call it level 7. Because it's been prayed since 1979. So praying for 600 is already included in my 1 billion. But as the time comes, we need to do our part. Which is why when we call this fast in April the 15th, that ends on April the 22nd, one of the things that I personally will do for the first 3 days, you know, but because it starts on Sunday, so Sunday I'm ministering, I will go on a total fast. I've gone a bit here, a bit there, here, a little bit, but most time on water. But total is no water, no food. And the last time I ever did that was in the second year in seminary. That was where I have the two mountains and the pillars of prayer, and Watchman Nee and John Zonor waving to me and the others. And so it is so significant that because I really live a fasted life, why should I fast some more? Correct. Some of you, your fast is one meal. Mine is one meal is normal. So the Lord said, push further. Wow, push further. How far shall we push? And so my 7 day fast, I'm going to do for the first 3 day total. And then God's pray, I'll hold me in prayer too. And then I flow by ear, how I'm going to flow by the Spirit, how I'm going to do the rest of the 4 days. But it's that important. And we are releasing something here. We are praying and building it in the Spirit. And that's why sometimes, you know, when you have prayed some of these things for so long, so many years, and you notice that when I talk about, I talk like, you know, like it's like going to eat wonton noodle. Because it's so inside, built inside. It's the DNA already. Already you'll be assimilated into it. And you know it's just going to come to pass. And it's impossible not to have it, in fact, with that much faith and belief in God. And it's only when, where, how that is God's choice. And so each one of you have a special work, special thing. Intensify in prayer. Intensify in prayer. And for some reason, go on to envelope and us to pray until the spiritual atmosphere starts changing even more in this nation. Can you imagine? Out of counting all the small little ones too, nearly 200 nations throughout the whole planet, that God would choose your nation to bring about this great revival. What an honor. What a privilege. And when you think about it, Singapore is also very tiny in terms of the whole planet Earth. Your population, 5 million, is smaller than some cities. Some cities are 10 million. That one city, the governor of the city is governing more people than your whole entire government. But yet, God has chosen you. God has chosen, and this nation was born with a destiny. His name, Singa Pura. He saw the lion. He always sees me as a lion. This is the lion city. Where the roar of the lion needs to go forth. Because the eagle has been sent to fly all over the place. Next stop, Russia. See, there is no coincidence, even the name of your nation. And what is the emblem of Judah? Lion. Now tell me, In which other nation of the world, 200 nations, their emblem is a lion? I know your emblem is something like the Malayan or something, but at least your nation is named after the lion. Germany is eagle, and US is eagle. You're a lion people. Not really that. They got their Union Jack and all that. See, it's funny, isn't it? Your nation, the lion nation. Wow. That means they're not going to pray like that. No. But when the angel plan things, let me tell you, they plan very detailed. Details that you and I might not see as important, but in the spiritual realm, very important. Very important. And this nation from its founding was chosen to be the place they got released this revival. It's not just meant for here, of course. We again say that. It's for the whole world. But it's always had to start from one place. Why do we keep calling the Pentecostal revival the Azusa Street revival? Why? Because it started there. But it was not meant to be there alone. It's meant to spread all over. And just only about 10 odd years ago or less than that, Christians are so hungry for revival. They want to go back to recall the Azusa Street revival. Instead of going forward, we're looking to history to get more. And yet God chose a combination of things that brought us to where we are. So know where we are. And the anointing you have received, the intensity that God is calling us to pray, and if we need to spend time praying and praying and praying in the Spirit, and let God do the job. The wonderful thing about this revival is the only hard work you do is in the Spirit. Praying, worshipping, right? You spend three nights worshipping here, correct? During your fast, and a lot of things have happened. And meditating on the word, and I know some of you, you know, got a secular job to go to, you know, by all means be faithful, do those things at the same time. Now you got extra unction, extra energy, and but the main work is in the spiritual. And as you keep doing it and keep doing it, it will intensify until it reaches a point that it becomes a tidal wave. And one country after the other, like the Second World War, slowly won back for the Lord as revival flows forth. So at this time, like Pastor David, you want to share more on this area? Yes, here's the...
Okay. Now, when we first went out, three of us, we went to Mount Faber. I saw Shama going to the angel on the tree there. Now when I say on the tree, he came down lower, but he's above, stationed above the tree. On Monday we went down to the base of the tree and we saw it was a huge, big tree. So it must have been, I'm not sure about Mount Faber, but when he was reclaim or make nice, they must have planted the tree when the nation was born. So that tree represents the stability of Singapore. And when Shama went to meet the angel, he gave him a flag, gave the angel a flag, a banner. And the banner states, Jehovah Shama, the presence of God. And we felt that, you know, this point of the island is a crucial point. Not just the economic places, but the government, the seat of government is there. And when we went to the east, I was quite surprised. I said, how come two angels? Then one, the sword was out there, and then one was facing to Malaysia. And then Shama met up with the angel, and these two angels, and gave this angel another banner, Jehovah Rapha. And I'll explain that later. Then we went to the north. We went to the north first. We went to the north, and then there was this angel, like Pastor said, very excited, like my kind of character. Wow, yeah, the flag. The moment the banner was given to the angel, so he started flying up and down. And I was very excited. I mean, kindred spirit. I saw him, I said, I was telling him, he's flying up and down, you know. So, came, like just now when you were dancing, your flag came near me, that kind of thing, fly, you know. I was, like, I have mentioned before, angels have characters, certain characteristics. This one really, typical me, now, then we went to the Bukit Timah Hill. We thought we would expect an angel there, but there was no angel. But Shama planted on top of Bukit Timah Hill, Jehovah Nisi, okay, the Lord my banner. And we traveled to the west. Now, all this traveling, Gunyo, very good driver, you know. I kept telling him, I said, if you had been with me in Turkey, then what mean kiani to ya? Anywhere, she will dry and she will know where to go. But Bopiena, the Lord want me to walk. So we went, actually, I knew, Shama said the angel is at this end. But it was blocked up, no entry, because the shipyard is there, all those. And Shama said, don't worry, I'll bring him over. So we went along here, and there was a canal. And we went there, and Shama said, okay, you wait here, I'll bring the angel over. So the angel came, and he was holding the flag, Jehovah, Shalom, peace. And we thought that would be the prayer walk by three of us. But when I came back, I saw in a dream the angel here talking to Shama, say, bring them here. Let them bless me, let them pray for me, let them empower me. And I told Pastor, I said, okay, we're going to do an around. So on Monday we went to Mount Faber first. And true enough, when we went there, I did say, Shama also told me the next day, say, you may expect some angels from the churches in Singapore. So actually, I expected quite a lot lah. But when we went to Mount Faber, but they were all waiting there, and we have to go down a slope. Some of us stayed up there, and that morning, I was thinking, must ask Gloria to bring the chauffeur, the horn, you know. Then Shama said, don't worry, she will bring. So when Gunyo brought me to Yunus and saw her, I said, she was carrying the thing. And then when she came, the angel said, yeah lah, I reminded her lah, you know. So it was good. So when we went there, we started singing and blowing the chauffeur. I didn't blow lah. I can blow three rapa, but not horn lah. I can blow trumpet, but not horn. So we were doing that, and then the tourists were all looking at us, but we were very bold. But those of us who were on the slope there, we were covered by trees. The one on top, they got to be more bold, because the tourists were all walking up and down. And then the angel came down from the tree, and we started blessing them. We started, I started to anoint them. They didn't see. I think Eddie was trying to came to my side, trying to look. But they were there. Then while we were praying for them and anointing them, one of the angels told me, say, pray for my pastor. He is passionate. He has passion, but he's sick. Pray for him. So after that, I prayed for him, but after that, I told the group. Okay. So, and then we moved on to the east again. And there were only three. I was looking around for more, but there were only three. Some of them, I think Esther was saying, oh, actually there is a lot of churches. But there are only three. As usual, the two angels were there and Sharma went up to talk to them. Then we started worship. We worship. So we started worshiping. And then Michael came. I mean, he came, he appeared as a light, but I knew it was Michael, and he shouted. He said, I bring the presence of God. And I told the group, let's kneel down. And we knelt down and we continued to pray. And there was a revelation given to Pastor Peter, because we have been thinking, why Jehovah Rapha healing? But then the Lord gave him the revelation that, you know, it's through healing that prosperity will come. Heal our businesses, heal our hearts, and after that, prosperity will come. So, there was one fisherman there, no? We were all kneeling down there. Wow, he caught a lot of fish, no, while we were praying. He caught, I think, four fishes, no? While we were praying, I think he got a blessing. So, and from there we went to the north. And as usual, the angels, and I thought he will never stop, because by then I saw the other angels already. I said, hey, you have to stop, you know, then we can settle down, and then we can bless. And then he did stop. Sharma brought him over and stopped. Then we worship, you know, worship, and then they came down, and then we blessed them. And then, I think as we progress, the Lord will reveal why there are, the north, there are more. After we prayed, two of them went towards the northwest, and the other five went towards the northeast. So, it's not for us to know which angel, which church they represent. But we know that there are churches who will come alongside. And you know, it is a spiritual thing. We are praying here, we prophesy here. It is a spiritual thing. They receive the anointing, they will influence the pastor. And it is going to start from there. Like Pastor Peter said, everything starts small, but you will grow. By the power of the anointing of God's triumph, it will grow. And then we went to West. Now, before, the day before, I was talking to Sharma. I said, hey, so many people, you know, 11 of us, if we go to the canal there, that is a protected area. I don't know whether the police will start coming and then, you know, condoning, and they say, hey, what you are doing here? Because it's really open land, and we walk the canal to the edge of the beach where there are a lot of fences, because they put out all those fences because the Indonesians are trying to illegally come in, you see. So we couldn't get to the beach. So I told Sharma, I said, can we go to another location? So I thought Jurong Bird Park, but I said, oh, there's one more place here, Raffles Marina. You can go there after your prayer walk. Can makan them. I said, okay, well, that's very good. So the last place we went to the marina. That one a bit tense. I told go, it cannot blow horn here. It's a club. Then we parked the car there, and then we came out, and then I said, hey, the angels go and choose the open patch there, just in front of the building. Open patch. They said, they are there, you know. So we said, okay, we worship, you know, so we start raising hand. Then the security chief kept looking, and he came and walked to us and said, what are you all doing? And pastor begin to say, I'm from Australia and I'm just walking around Singapore and they are bringing me around Singapore. I say, okay lah, he say that, we all keep quiet. So he said, oh no, you can go in. I said, no, okay, we will go in soon. But yeah, go in. And at last he revealed, say, I'm a bit disturbed. Like, why all of you standing here? And then, you know, pointing to the patch there. And then over the patch, after the patch are all the yachts and the ship parked. And I say, I'm afraid you want to steal one of them. So we say, no. We are just here observing and looking. Like, we will finish. So he left us alone and then we finished praying. So, well, I think this is the kind of work we are doing here, prophetically, praying, blessing. I always believe that there are always an angel or even two or three in every church. And from my own experience in my very first church, I have always seen my church angel at the fourth pew. You know, if the pulpit is here, last time, we are still from Brethren Church, all the pew is all the wooden pew, you know, cushion and then wooden back. Then the pews, at the fourth pew, the angel is always standing there. But my church was very conservative, very anti. Even when they read the Bible where the spirit is there, they just keep it, you know. The word spirit of God, just keep it, or they won't. They'll try not to read any verse that has the Spirit of God there. They are that anti. So the angel was constrained. The angel could not do the work that it was tasked. But yet, every week, I would observe, because there was one prayer meeting like this, overnight prayer meeting. I was sitting on the fourth row. I was sitting on the last pew. And then, when you sit there, it's a cushion. If someone else sits on it, you tum, you know, the cushion tum, tum. I mean, that time was not so heavy yet. So I was sitting and praying. Tum. I thought someone sat beside me. Look, bolang, saw the angel there. So that was first time I saw the angel standing there. And then, subsequently, every Sunday, I'll try to sit behind and look at angel there. Every time the fourth pew, the one who sits at the corner get ministered to. The one who will sit there will cry or receive a word of knowledge, you know, and they are always ministered to. Even one time my nephew was sitting there, and then he said, oh, I want to go on a mission. So angels, they still work their way, but they can be constrained. We believe all these 18 angels, they represent 18 churches in Singapore. It is not a last number, but it is good enough. When the revival fire starts from us here, concurrently they will be challenging their pastors. They will be leading, guiding their pastors. So afterwards, when we pray especially for this angel that say his pastor is passionate but physically weak, sick. So remember him in prayer. Alright. Just now, pastor talked about the lion roaring. It was a dream that I received last week. I saw a lion rising up from the dust, from the ground. You know, it was on the ground, and it rose up from the ground, and it started to shake. And then all the dust, you know, because it was lying on the ground, and it started to shake off all the dust. At the same time, on the tree, a fully grown eaglet jumped out of his nest, and then it jumped from branch to branch, three branches, jumped branch to branch. The last branch, it leapt out and it started to fly, and the eagle flew to the lion above, you know, and then the lion roar. I don't to compete. Just now his roar was loud, but I tell you, mine can be louder. But the lion roar, wow. I don't show off, okay. But the lion roar, then it start to trout. Then the eagle followed. Then it started to trout. All sorts of land animals started to follow the lion. And then all sorts of birds follow the eagle. And then the lion started to run. And the eagle follow. And then more and more followed. And he went to meshes, he went to lands, dry land, open land. He just keep on picking up speed. And then it grew in great numbers. And I wrote to him, "Hey, I think that is about us lah. You roar, I fly lah. Fair and square. In Turkey, I walk, you walk in spirit. I say, this one I fly, I glide. You can run. God is fair. But I think, you know, the eagle, Sifa, you know, prophetic, that's my role. He is on land, he lead. He leads the growth, and this is exciting time for us, for our church. How many are there here? Not many, but don't look at the human, look at the angels. Today, the 18 are here, they are still waiting for us to pray. After we pray, release prayer, they will go back. And you still have your angels, and you still have your assigned angels for prayer. So we are crowded in a way. All right, there is a large crowd with us. So we are. Tonight, we will focus on praying for Singapore churches. And I would like us to, let me see. I'd like us to pray according to the seven characters of the seven churches. In Ephesus, we have the loveless church. The church of Ephesus speak of the loveless church. Let's pray for a stirring of works out of love, first love. Singapore churches, we are one of the biggest supporters of mission. Millions and millions of dollars out of all these generous churches. But being a missionary, I have seen a lot of work become very secular. I do not discredit my fellow missionaries or all this, but I see so much corruption in mission work. This is why I have a struggle myself. There are pastors, like, for example, Cambodia. There are pastors that are growing so rich and so corrupted. And yet, churches dare not make firm decisions. They still continue to give. My previous church, okay, the one that I grew up in, last year had a crisis. For the last 30 years, they have been supporting this orphanage in northern Thailand. And they pump in a lot of money, they bring in mission teams every year, two times, three times. They buy lands, they build this and build that. But all in the name of the pastor's wife and the pastor. Last year, they absconded with the property, everything. And the orphanages there are all abandoned. And that is just one of many of such incidences. In Cambodia, I know of the crooks who call themselves pastors. I know of how they arrange teaching seminars. They have this American, I won't call him pastor, but he organizer. He will organize, get a few speakers from America to come to Cambodia and do teaching seminar. They call it leadership seminar and all those things. But the people who come to seminars are all those from the street. This American guy will pay this each one $1 US. Come to attend. And then three meals provided. They are not Christian. And then when they sing, they all sing. And you say, wow, you want how many people? 300. We give you 300. You want 600? We give you 600. I was approached like this also by a young man who said, Pastor, oh, I would like to organize a teaching seminar for you. You know, I can bring in 200 people, 300. I say, yeah, what's the catch? He said, oh, $10,000 US budget. So a lot of work is just done like this. We have lost the first love. So this is one of the things we must pray. For the church of Smyrna, the persecuted church. If you read my update, persecution will increase. You want to talk about revival without persecution? I think it does not happen. Revival comes usually. One of the things that drives revival is persecution, you know. So the Lord, but the Lord wants to strengthen us, those who are persecuted. So let's pray for that. Then you have the Church of Pergamos, the compromising church. And then Thyatira, the corrupt church. I know someone who has never seen angel before, but went to Thyatira and saw the angel of Thyatira, where I described he was. Okay. Angels, they are everywhere. Then, the Church of Sardis, the dead church. If you recall my article, so I had two dreams. One dream of a body lying down as though dead, but it was just hardly alive. It was just there was hardly any breathing, just hardly alive. And that was the vision that God gave concerning our churches. And then another vision was I was brought down to the earth, under the ground, and I saw a whole town buried. All the people, animals, children, everyone buried. I was there. I walked in the town. It was so suffocating. And there was death everywhere. And this is how some churches are. Dead. No life. I don't know. I think you have friends or family members even who really are just so sick of church. But still have to go, because you are Christian, you know. Because why? Oh, I want my children to go to church also when they grow up, so you go. I don't know. There is such deadness in our churches also. But praise the Lord, there are churches that are faithful. Okay, Philadelphia. The 18 churches here, I believe the pastors are faithful. Okay, and then the lukewarm church. Pastor on Thursday teaching gave a very good insight to that, what it means to be lukewarm, neither hot. And Christ said, I wish you were either hot or cold. If you are hot, I can use. If you are cold, I don't need you. I can, in my own power, I can conquer. But if you are lukewarm, you're always resisting. And that goes back to my first vision when I was in Ephesus. How in spiritual warfare, it is not just the angels of God against the evil powers, evil spirits, but it is the spirit of man and woman taking the side of the evil, warring against the angels. I hope that we realize this. I hope that in churches here, pastors realize this, that if we are not for God, we are against God. There is no middle position. We are either for God or we are against Him. So let's pray on all these things also. Okay? Will there be Q&A? Just a bit. Maybe no. Let's push the thing. Q&A. Next week, maybe. I think because the angels are all excited. Okay. After all this talk and then Q&A and then, you know, talk about them, they say, hey, don't need to talk about me lah. Let's do the work. Okay? So, let's proceed on. Do you have anything else to add? I want us to sing some song. Okay. Tak. Come. My son is called Atak. No? He's Linus to you, but he's Atak to me. Okay, his name is Atak. Atak to. I mean, the grandmother called him Atak. Tak to. So, Cantonese Tak. Okay. This one? Sing this one first. After you. Now, Pastor, you also come lah. Huh? You did. We will flow in worship first. Okay? And when it's time to pray and prophesy, get your notepad ready, get your pen ready. Let's rise.
Lord, I worship. Holy. blood of the Lamb, I will enter to worship you only. I enter to honor, I am Lord.
Holy God, how all
the presence of a holy God. The presence of your glory, all my crowns lie in the dust. You are righteous in your judgments, Lord. You are faithful, true, and just. Us, Lord, open our eyes to see your glory, your reign, Lord, your supreme triumph, Lord, over all creation, over all mankind. Open up our hearts, Lord, open up our spirit, Lord. Lord, let all this prayer, all this prophetic prayer go forth in your name, Lord, and awaken your churches, Lord, for your glory, Lord. Come, Lord, we cry out, Lord. And I cry, holy, holy, holy God. Music linger. Let the presence of God linger. If you have the word right now, write them down. If you have the word of prophecy, write them down. Pray them. We're going to take this moment, just a moment, just for you to prophesy to the churches here, to the churches all over. You can sit down if you want. Then after that, we're going to sing some more. Go on. We're going to go on and press on. Muscle of the teacher.
keep on praying. When all things that surround like a shadow in the light of you. When I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround the shadows see the light of you. I worship you. Your name, oh Lord,
praise us to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. Come on, let's give glory to the Lord. I give glory to your name. Oh Lord, glory to your name. Glory to your name. Oh Lord, glory to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. One more time, I give glory. I give glory to your name, oh Lord, glory to your name, oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. Glory to your name, oh Lord, glory to your name, oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be your name is great and greatly to be praised.